Good afternoon, everybody.
So I'd like to introduce our colloquium speaker for today. David Pine is our speaker. He's visiting from NYU. David received his PhD in physics from Cornell University. He was a postdoc at the University of Pittsburgh and then an assistant professor of physics at Haverford College. In 1990, he moved to the research and engineering group at Exxon. In 1995, he moved again to the University of California at Santa Barbara. There he was professor of materials, a professor of chemical engineering, and eventually chair of chemical engineering. In 2005, David moved again, and this time to NYU Physics Department, where he currently runs his research lab. David's research is in the area of experimental soft condensed matter physics. He's done important work on problems in colloidal physics, in polymers, emulsions, and rheology. And this work has won David many distinctions, and it's also one of many invited professorships, which allow him to do physics in even more places. So today, David's talk will be about his group's recent work on colloids with directional interactions.
Okay, thank you, Derek. First thing you've learned about me is that I can't hold down a job. But what I want to tell you about today is some work that we've been doing started about 10 years ago and has kept us busy for a good while, and will probably keep us busy for a good while longer. So one of the things that I think is a big challenge for material science, at least in this century, is to figure out how to build materials in a sophisticated way in what I've labeled here as the colloidal regime. At smaller length scales, down around angstroms, chemists are extremely good at making molecules both simple and complex in a way that I think shames what we physicists can do. It's pretty amazing what they can make and what they can fashion from atoms. At longer length scales, you know, we can make cars, cameras, even watches are pretty amazing if you look inside at the small parts. Down here in this regime, well, we can make electronics well. All right, we can make very nice two-dimensional structures that can do electronic tasks. But when it comes to making a real three-dimensional machinery or three-dimensional materials, in this mesoscopic or colloidal length scales, we're not so good. We're better both at shorter and at longer length scales. So one of the things that I've been interested in some time is trying to develop ways of building materials on these length scales. So the approach that we take in my group, that lots, maybe even most people interested in this kind of science take, is self-assembly, that is trying to exploit the fundamental forces between these particles, the statistical mechanics, to try and assemble, have these materials actually assemble into the structures that you'd like them to have. So I deal with colloids. Colloids conveniently come in a variety of materials. So when I talk about colloids, basically what I mean is particles that are clearly bigger than molecules, but still small enough so that if you throw them in a liquid, the thermal agitation is enough to keep them suspended. So that generally means particles in this size regime, from a few nanometers to a few microns. Like I said, these materials conveniently come in all kinds of types. You have plastics like polystyrene or polymethyl methacrylate. So most of your cups are made out of polystyrene. Acrylic is polymethyl methacrylate. You can get inorganic materials like silica or titania or lots of other inorganics. Semiconductors such as cadmium sulfide. Metals such as gold, silver. So you have a lot of building blocks in terms of types of materials to work with The real challenge is to be able to put them together to form different kinds of structures. So the simplest sort of structure that you can make, and this turns out not to be too hard, is just a self-assembly of hard spheres. So if you think of a colloid as simply having only a repulsive potential that's equal to its radius, that's the only way it interacts with other particles, that system has the world's simplest phase diagram, or at least a pretty simple one. Temperature isn't involved because a potential here is either infinity or zero. And the phase diagram is simply that you get a disordered liquid, we might call it, below 49.4%. And between 54.5% and 74%, you get a face-centered cubic crystal. And in between here, you have coexistence between the liquid and crystalline phase. So if you take some colloid, and one of the nice things that chemists have taught us how to do is how to make these colloidal particles so that they all have the same size. This allows us to do nice studies of model systems. So you can make, for example, these are polystyrene spheres that were made in my lab. And you can densify them in a suspension, and they will form this face-centered cubic crystal. And then when you dry them out and look at them with an electron microscope, you can see this nice ordered array of spheres. By the way, for those of you not in the field, this is sort of an interesting phase diagram. Notice up here that you have this face-centered cubic crystal. That is, this arrangement of spheres at 55%, is preferred to this arrangement of spheres. And the reason is that this one has lower entropy than that one. Okay? So the statement that your teachers may have told you that entropy equals disorder may need a different definition of disorder. This apparently is more disordered than that. All right? But it's true, each of these spheres have more entropy, basically because by ordering themselves in an array, each particle has more room in which to move, and therefore more entropy than this arrangement does. if you charge up the colloids, so if you put charges on their surfaces and put them, say, in water or alcohol, they'll form a slightly more interesting phase diagram. Down at low volume fractions, you'll get a base, a body-centered cubic crystal, in addition to the face-centered cubic crystal that you got before. You still get a liquid. Up here, calculations tell us that you should have a face-centered cubic crystal, but it's actually a glass, presumably because of kinetic reasons. so this is a little bit richer, a little bit more you can do with these systems. Nature actually makes ordered colloids all by itself. You have to pay some money for it because it doesn't do it very often. But this is from sediments off Australia. And what these sediments, by the way, we call these sediments opal. All right. If you break them open and look inside with an electron microscope, this is what you see. You see nice ordered crystalline arrays of silica, basically. The colors you see here come about because you get Bragg scattering off of these crystalline planes. The Bragg scattering occurs at optical wavelengths, so the colors you see are in the visible. You see different colors here just because you have crystallites in different orientations, and so the light is scattering off of different crystalline planes and giving you these different colors. Down here, this is an experiment done by Peter Pusey and Bill Van Magen back in 1986. And if you look at it, it's not quite as vivid as this picture, but you see the same kinds of flecks of color. And this was actually the first demonstration that colloids that interacted through what is basically a hard sphere interaction do indeed form colloidal crystals, and these are this is the Bragg scattering that you can see from those crystals. Now, This is something we'd like to make, all right? This is a diamond crystal, all right? And it would be very interesting to make a colloidal crystal that had a diamond lattice. One of the reasons is this paper that was written by Costa Tsoukalos at Iowa State and his colleagues. They calculated the optical band structure of a colloidal crystal made in the diamond structure. And what they found is that between the second and third bands, there's a band gap. This is entirely analogous to an electronic band gap, except it occurs for optical radiation. And it's quite a wide band gap. All you need to do is make the contrast in refractive index between the spheres and the outside region about 2, which is readily doable. and the spheres should actually touch each other, not like they're shown here. The spheres should be big enough to touch each other. Now, this would be a very nice device to make, a very nice material to make, because it would have all sorts of interesting optical properties analogous to electrical semiconductors. People have tried to make this, and the report is, after 24 years, nobody's been able to do it. All right, so it's a bit embarrassing to the community of scientists who work in colloids that we haven't been able to make a structure like this. So you might ask, well, why not? One thing, it turns out, if you want to make a packing of particles, and in this case, we'll talk about a packing of spheres, you can show that in order for that packing to be stable, mechanically stable, each particle has to have, on average, 2 constraints for each degree of freedom it has. So if it has fewer than that, it's not mechanically stable. So if you have spheres, each particle has 3 degrees of freedom. Each particle needs, on average, 6 constraints. So if you look at a body-centered cubic crystal like we have here, you see each particle has 8 nearest neighbors, and the particles are nicely constrained, and this is a stable structure. In FCC, there are 12 nearest neighbors. If you look in a diamond lattice, you see that each particle only has 4 nearest neighbors. And if you've ever taken any kind of, like they have these mag toys that you can put spheres together with little magnets and try to assemble a diamond crystal, you'll find that it's very floppy and it falls apart in your hands for precisely this reason. So then you might ask yourself, well, what about diamond? You know, that stuff that's made out of carbon, why does it seem to be so stable? And the answer is there are a few more constraints it has. Namely, these bonds between their nearest neighbors are not just constrained in terms of their translational symmetry, they're also constrained in terms of rotations. That is, these bonds, these sp3 hybrid orbital bonds, are constrained such that they essentially have a torsional spring constant that constrains them from moving torsionally. So each one of these bonds has 2 torsional constraints against motion this way and motion that way. And so that now gives each particle 12 constraints, and the system is stable. So the question that occurred to me some time ago is, if we could do this with colloids, we could make a stable diamond crystal from colloids. So that began my lab sort of on a journey to try and make colloids with directional interactions. so, you know, molecules have them, like here is methane or carbon dioxide or water. Because of quantum mechanics, because of the nature of quantum mechanics, these kinds of systems interact in such a way as to develop directional bonds. We don't have that with colloids, so the question is, how do we make it? All right, so the rest of the talk is really about a few different things that we've come up with to try and make colloids with directional bonds. I should say, just by way of background, until very recently, if you had a colloidal sphere, the shape determined everything. So the fact that the colloid is spherical in shape means that its interactions with its neighbors are spherically symmetric. All right, there was no way anybody had of making those interactions anything but spherically symmetric. All right, so I'll tell you a couple different stories. The first one is making colloids with valence. So there's a method to this, and I'll just explain the method. So we start out with some polystyrene spheres. So polystyrene is just this long linear chain molecule. You can make them so they form little spheres. You can cross-link the chains. So what you essentially have here is a little net of a polystyrene, of cross-linked polystyrene. We disperse it in some solvent, typically toluene. Over here we have soapy water. And what you do then is you put it into a mixer and just mix it up. And when you do that, you make little toluene, little oil droplets in water. And if you're careful and you think hard about it, you can figure out how to make these droplets so that each droplet only has a few polystyrene particles in it, 2, 3, 4, something like that. Then you can suck all the toluene out. You can do this both osmotically or just by heating it up. The toluene will evaporate faster than the water. And when you do that, These droplets that had three or four spheres in them will make clusters with four spheres or three spheres or two spheres. These clusters are charged, but it turns out if you get them close to each other like this, because of the van der Waals interaction, they will stick irreversibly to each other. The van der Waals force between spheres that are about a micron in size is about 1,000 or a few thousand KT. So they stick together irreversibly. So van der Waals holds these things together. The fact that the clusters, the spheres are charged, means that these clusters will stay away from each other. So these systems are pretty stable. Here's a picture that my graduate students took. This is an emulsion droplet observed under a optical microscope. There are 7 polystyrene spheres inside, and the toluene is evaporating into the water as you watch. And you can see as that happens, the spheres get more crowded together. There's a little pop here that happens in a second. There it is. And it forms a cluster, if you look at it under the electron microscope, that looks like this. So there's 5 spheres in a pentagon. There's 1 sphere above and there's 1 behind that you can't see. And you make this cluster of 7 spheres. The thing that's interesting about this is every single time you have 7 spheres, it makes this cluster. It never makes anything else. And so if you look at clusters, here's clusters 2, 3, 4 through 11, I guess. These happen to be the clusters that minimize the second moment of the mass distribution as calculated by this guy, a mathematician who studies sphere packings at Princeton. And if you compare those to the clusters we form, you find that we see the same thing. All right. So these are the clusters we make. So this is step one, is to make clusters like this. Step two is this. So we take some spheres, say we make a tetrahedron like this. And then what you do is you add, so these spheres are made out of polystyrene, which is this polymerized styrene. Then what you do is you add some styrene, and if you do it carefully, the styrene will swell these particles, and they'll swell it so a little bit of the polystyrene spheres stick out from the styrene liquid. Then what you can do is you can polymerize this styrene liquid, and you end up with something like this with these little patches of the original spheres that stick out. Here's what it looks like in real life. So here's an SEM of clusters. So here's the tetrahedron, and here's the patchy tetrahedron that's made through the swelling process. And you can see it has patches that come from the original spheres. All right. Nice thing about this is that the symmetry you get of the patches is determined by the symmetry of the underlying clusters. Now, the other thing that I didn't tell you so far is when you make these polystyrene spheres, you can put different chemical groups on the surfaces depending upon how you do the polymerization process. So in this particular one, we put amidine groups on the surface of these spheres. But for the styrene over here that we swelled it with, it didn't have any amidine groups in it. So when we polymerized this, the amidine groups are only on the patches. They're not on this, what I might call, matrix material. All right, and what that means is we can now do some chemistry on the patches that will happen only on the patches and not on the matrix. So the idea is this. You take, there's a very common protein called biotin, and we can react it so that it binds to these amidine groups. Then what you can do, and I'll explain a little bit more about this in a second, is you can, there's another protein called streptavidin. Nice thing for physicists is you can just order streptavidin from a company, and it will already have DNA attached to it. So when you combine streptavidin and there's biotin around, the streptavidin will bind to the biotin like this. And so what that means is you ultimately have DNA coming off of these patches and only off of these patches. Now, one nice thing, too, is you can buy this streptavidin so that it's fluorescently labeled. So you can actually check after you put the streptavidin and DNA on your particles, you can actually check with a microscope to see if it's gone where you think it's gone. I was supposed to have a slide there. I must have delayed it. All right, it'll come. All right, so let's explain a little bit about the DNA. So we have DNA on these particles, and at the end of the DNA, so the DNA is sometimes it's double-stranded, sometimes it's single-stranded. For sake of simplicity of understanding, I show double-stranded here, and then at the end of it, there'll be a little segment that's single-stranded. And what you do is you pick, you can just order these with a specific sequence of bases. And you all remember that when you have DNA, it forms a double helix, and you get binding between two pairs of different types of bases. There's a thymine, adenine that bind together, and there's guanine, cytosine, GC and TA. So you can program it, and if this end has a sequence of bases that are complementary to this end, these will bind. And if they're not complementary, it won't bind. So what the nice thing is you can program in which things bind to each other and which things don't bind to each other. The other convenient thing about DNA is it's activated around room temperature. So it turns out that for something that's like this with maybe eight bases that are going to bind to each other, they will bind to each other if the temperature is less than about 40 degrees Celsius, and they will unbind if it's above 40 degrees Celsius. So you can make these things bind and unbind just by raising the temperature a little bit around body temperature. All right, so the pictures I've shown you thus far are very misleading in terms of scale. This one is meant to show you what the real scale is. So here's our polystyrene sphere over here that's 1 micron in diameter. All right, so it's taking up the better part of the front of this room. Here's the streptavidin biotin linkage. Here's the DNA coming off. This is some polymer here that adsorbs on the surface. This is useful for keeping the colloidal particles from sticking to each other when you don't want them to. Here's what the DNA looks like. You can see at the end here is this single-stranded piece of 8 or 10 bases that's going to be used for binding. All right, so here is where we look at the functionalization of the patches, and you can see where we have three patches, we see three patches under the fluorescent microscope due to the fluorescent labeling of the streptavidin. Four patches, you see 4, 5, 5. And so this all works very nicely, just like we want it to. So then what we did is we took some single patch particles that had complementary sets of DNA, and we threw them into a beaker of water. And when you do that, what you see, if you wait a little while, is you see a bunch of doublets forming. And you only see doublets forming. That's it, nothing else. And if you look at these doublets under a fluorescent microscope, what you see is that they always occur in green-red pairs. the green labels one type of DNA, and the red labels the DNA that's its complement. So we know not only are they forming pairs, but they're forming pairs because of the specific binding between the DNA that we programmed in. So we get nice programmable, specific, and directional bonding. You can get a little more complicated and put in, you can make particles with two patches and then bind them to particles with one patch. And again, what you see is you see a bunch of triplets. Here's something that hasn't reacted yet. And again, you see things occurring in green-red pairs in every case. Get more complicated. Here's one with an AB3 structure. Here's the one that we were really interested in making, the AB4 structure, because it has the symmetry of diamond. So this is sort of like a colloidal methane molecule. You can also make chains by putting in two-patch particles of different types. And when you get these chains forming, and when you look under the fluorescent microscope, again, you always see these green-red pairs for any particles that are bound together. So this is a nice method for assembling particles the way you want to. So here's what it actually looks like under a microscope when you're watching it. And you can see these particles are batted around by Brownian motion. They just diffuse nicely like that. When you make a methane molecule, a real methane molecule out of carbon and hydrogen, the reaction, the time it takes them to react is typically picoseconds or less. The nice thing about colloids is they're a little bit slower, and you can actually watch the chemistry occur in real time. And this isn't four times the play rate because there's a new version of Keynote, and Apple saw it fit in their infinite wisdom to disable this ability. But you can see that's just a binding between a four-patch particle, and a first particle comes on. Now we watch the second particle come on right here. In a second. Now it's bound. And then you wait a few minutes. And you'll see the next one bind. You can actually model this process with a reaction diffusion equation. And you find that these times are the right times based on what the diffusion coefficient is. This last one, of course, takes longer to react than the previous ones because there's only one patch unreacted left for a particle to go onto. So it takes more time for it to find that patch than it took for particles to find one of the initial patches. But you can actually watch the chemistry going on, and you can model this, and it works out more or less like you expect it to. This one also isn't fast, so I won't wait to show the whole thing. But here what you can see is the formation of these chains. What you see is that it occurs primarily by the addition of single particles at this stage of the game, when there are many more singlets than there are chains. So you tend to get chain formation by single particle addition. And so you can see you can watch the whole buildup of a long colloidal polymer like this. One of the things that's important to be able to control is patch size. So we can control the size of the patches by controlling how much styrene we swell with. And so if you make the patches small, you just get single particles binding. If you make the patches bigger, you can get two particles binding to one site. So you have some versatility there, too, in what you can do. All right, so that's the first example of directional type interactions. The second one is officially called lock and key particles. And that's what we called it in all our publications. But in the lab, we refer to these as Pac-Man particles. All right, so here's our Pac-Man particles. This is inspired by proteins. So one of the cartoons for how proteins bind specifically to each other is that two proteins that bind specifically to each other might have complementary shapes so that they fit together sort of like Lego blocks. And if they have the wrong shapes, they don't fit together. So we wanted to see if we could do something like that with colloids. So the idea here was to make a colloid with a little scoop out of it that a sphere could fit into, and it would only fit into it if it were the right size. So that was the goal. So the first part of this story, so I'll tell you right away, I had what I thought was a brilliant method for making these particles. It was nice. We had already made them. But I'd hired a new postdoc named Stefano Sicana, and I told him about my scheme. And he was kind enough to tell me that he thought that that was a nice scheme, but he wanted to think about it himself a little bit. And he came back about a week later with an idea that sounded crazy, but here it is. It starts with a molecule called TPM. There it is. Chemists can pronounce it. This is a methacrylate group on one end. This is a siloxane group on the other end. It doesn't mix with water, so there it is. We call it an oil and water. If you shake it, you make a bunch of little tiny TPM droplets in the water. It turns white because they all scatter light. So that's the first step. Second step is you raise the pH of the water so that it's basic. And what that does is it causes these siloxane groups to react with each other slowly. And what they do is they make oligomers. Oligomers of anywhere from 1 to about 12 molecules. So you have a broad distribution. So that's step one. Step two, you attack this methacrylate group by adding a free radical out here, which causes these to polymerize. That happens fairly quickly. And because the free radical is on the outside and it happens quickly, you form a shell on the outside. The shell is porous. It has pores on the 3 or 4 to 5 nanometer scale, which is typical of anything made with silica, that is silicon and oxygen. It also causes what residual TPM there was dissolved into water to immediately form little nanoparticles. And what that means is that there are no monomers of TPM, no dimers of TPM, no trimers of TPM out here, but there are inside the droplet. So that means there's an osmotic imbalance between the two, and what happens is the small oligomers of TPM diffuse through this porous shell out here. That creates a pressure difference. The pressure in here falls relative to the pressure in here, and it buckles. Like that. All right. So I ask all the professors in the audience, would you believe your postdoc if he came to you with a story like that? I actually knew he was pretty smart, so I told him to try it. And here's what he came back with a few weeks later. Look at those. See those beautiful dimples? They're all formed this way. All right. All right, so that's step one. What do we do with these things? All right, so we use something called the depletion interaction. All right. So for those of you, the colloid people know this, but the rest of you won't. So suppose you have two colloidal particles in a suspension, and you also add a whole bunch of small polymer molecules. So that's what these are meant to be. Now, if you want to go and calculate the free energy of this system, it's dominated by the entropy of these polymers, because there's so many more of them than there are of these colloids. So you can do a simple calculation. Since it's just entropic, you can use the ideal gas law expression for the entropy, which says that the entropy goes as the number density of the polymer times the log of the volume available to the polymer. Now, here's the clever thing. The volume available to them isn't sort of immediately obvious. The volume is this volume I've shown in blue here. That is, the center of a polymer particle can only get within its own radius of the colloid here. Its center is excluded from this halo around each particle. All right. This was first realized by two Japanese scientists, Asakura and Asawa, back in 1954. And so what they said is, they said, this is a pure theory paper, by the way. one page long. And they said, if these two particles accidentally come together, which they'll do by Brownian motion, these exclusion volumes will overlap. So you can't exclude that volume twice. And what that means is that the volume available to the polymer has grown by this much. That means the entropy of this situation is bigger. The free energy is lower. And if you calculate it, it's lower by, 10 to 15 kT for a typical situation. So they ought to bind to each other. OK, this is where we do a brief intermission. All right. These guys wrote this paper in 1954. All right. This is to encourage everybody whose citations are low. All right. So how was this paper cited? All right. So up to 1980, they got five citations. And I know for a fact that this citation in 1958 and this one in 1963 was by Asakura and Osawa themselves. All right. So after 25 years, nobody had noticed their papers. How many in here have papers like that? All right. In the 1980s, things picked up. They got 63 citations by the end of the 1980s. This is when I noticed it. I noticed it in 1989, as a few of my colleagues did. (laughs) 1,529 citations as of this morning, all right? And this really is a classic in the colloid literature. This is a beautiful, beautiful idea, and it's one that all of us use all the time, starting in about 1990, to control attractive interactions between colloids. These guys were just brilliant. It just took the rest of us about 35 years to realize it. Our idea was to use this with these lock and key particles we've made, these Pac-Men. So if you do the same argument, what you realize is if you have a sphere going inside of a particle with one of these things dug out of it, the overlap volume is huge, much bigger than for this orientation, and much bigger than it would be for a particle that was too small. So since you can tune the strength of this interaction by tuning the polymer density, you can arrange it so that this volume is too small to cause permanent binding, and this volume is big enough to cause permanent binding. All right, so let's watch. So what I want you to do is I want you to watch this Pac-Man particle. By the way, here's the genius. We refer to him as the wizard. All right. Boom, see that? Isn't that cool? You can keep watching this one because the show's not over. You notice other particles come down and stick to it, but then come off because the attraction isn't strong enough. Now look at that. And see how the bond is flexible like this. I don't think anybody's ever made a flexible colloidal bond before this. All right. So this is entropy in action, all right? And for those of you who think it's an abstract concept, here it is as concrete as can be. You can make a model of this. It's basically you have a lock and a key reacting to form a lock key. In your stat-met course, you learn about the law of mass action. You can write it down for this system. You can calculate the energies involved. There's the binding energy due to the depletion interaction that you can calculate. There's an entropic term here. The entropic term actually turns out to be important. When this sphere locks in here, it loses entropy because before it's free to move about and then it's locked in. When it binds, it can still move around if it's not too perfectly matched to the radius here. And what you can show is if it's perfectly matched, the entropic sacrifice by going from free to bound is too big to, and it actually overcomes the binding energy and it shouldn't bind. And I don't have time to show you the data today, but it turns out that this is exactly true. These particles have to be a little bit smaller, about 10% to 15% smaller in radius than this radius is here in order for the binding to occur. So again, entropy is playing a key role here in deciding when these things bind and don't bind. Here's some curves. I won't go through this today, but this is just to show that this little model captures the behavior of binding between these lock and key particles. Here's another thing that we thought was fun to do. You can use for the polymer something called polynepam. These are gel particles, and water is a good solvent for them only below about 30 degrees. As you heat it up, water becomes a poorer and poorer solvent, and eventually at about 40, 45 degrees, they actually precipitate out of the water. But before they do, they shrink. That is, here they're all swollen by the solvent because they like the solvent. Over here, up near 40 degrees, they've shrunken into little balls because the solvent isn't, they don't like to be dissolved in it so much anymore. What that should do to the depletion interaction is it should decrease it enormously because it decreases this overlap volume. So we exploited that here in this, this movie. See, do I have to click? Yeah, again, it should go faster, but Apple's got me. So watch these here. So what we do here is we start it at room temperature and we heat it up to 40 degrees. So it's at 38 degrees, then 40, they come apart. And if you cool it down, they come together again, come apart, come together. So you can control this with temperature. Here's another way to make Pac-Man. How are we doing on time? I'll show you this. With this is just sort of a cute tech. This is actually more the technique I had in mind with some nice improvements by Stefano. Here what you do is you start out with some spheres. We typically use polystyrene or silica. And you take this TPM, if you hydrolyze it, you put a little OH groups here, it will actually dissolve in water. And then what you do is you raise the pH and these things start reacting with each other. And as they react, the molecules get bigger. And since it's just barely dissolved in water, they start to precipitate out. In the presence of these spheres, red spheres serve as nucleation sites. And so the TPM will nucleate on here and form little droplets. And those droplets will grow. And it takes about a half hour. When they've gotten to a size that you like, you stop adding TPM, you polymerize these droplets, and then you attack the seeds with some kind of solvent to dissolve them away, and you end up with these nice Pac-Man particles. So if you look at the real thing, here's our seeds. Here's what they look like after we grow the TPM onto it. And then after we dissolve out, the particles, they look like this. So these are sort of what we call our designer Pac-Man, because they have much more well-defined shapes than the others do. And these are more specific in their binding. That is, you really have to have just the right sphere size for these to bind. They accept a much narrower range of sphere radii than do the other Pac-Man. So there's the old ones for comparison. I'll show you one sort of last thing about this. This is what we want to do with these things, and so we're not quite there yet. We're getting close. What we'd like to do is we'd like to make a string of big mouth and small mouth Pac-Man like this and hook them together. The way we do this is this is something we just perfected. We can put DNA on the outside, on the convex part of these particles. And then the idea is to put them in a line, have the DNA on the different particles bind to each other. And then it turns out, in a way I'll tell you about in a second, we can make this binding permanent. We can cause a covalent bond to form, which will keep these from ever going apart if we want. But here's the idea. We start with this. And we have the temperature at 40 degrees, so we have this temperature-dependent depletion reaction, which I showed you already. And then you put a bunch of spheres, big and small ones, in there, and you lower the temperature to 30 degrees. And so the particles should all go to their appropriate sites because of this specific bonding interaction that depends on the size of the particles and the holes. Then you add some more Pac-Men, and what they should do is they should glom on to these spheres. Then all these spheres have DNA on them, so they should bind to each other. And what we've done is we've added a molecule called cinnamate. This is another chemistry that one of my colleagues in the chemistry department at NYU helped us develop. When you expose it to ultraviolet light, it will form it'll undergo a transition. Bonds will break and then reform. And what you'll get is a permanent covalent bond between the two DNA strands. So we flash it with ultraviolet light, makes a permanent bond, you heat it up to 40 degrees, and you should have, oops. And you should have a copy. So the idea here is to make self-replicating systems. And then the idea is to see if we can get exponential growth. If we can get exponential growth, to see, basically to study evolution, to see if there are mistakes that occur, and to see if there are preferential ones that propagate in favor of others, and things like that. We'd also like to use this as a method for a manufacturing method, for starting with structures of one of a particular shape and then replicating them to make massive quantities of them. We can make a whole bunch of different types of particles with this method I just showed you. here's one just to show you some of the things we can make. We can make little lens particles like this, convex lenses. We can make particles that essentially have a flat cut off of them, and I won't go into the various experiments that we're doing with these today, but I can tell you about them sometime. We can make little contact lenses like this. Here's a better picture of them. So this electron microscope of these contact lens particles. Here's a scale bar, 1 micron. This is actually a high school student who made these. She's really good. She's also a great violist, but she made these this past summer, and she's doing some work in my lab. So these are little micro lenses. This is what they look like under an optical microscope when you have this suspended in water, so you can see them undergoing Brownian motion. And then if you put them in a suspension and add a depletant, you get structures that look like this. You can see they sort of cup with each other like this and form these complex structures. So we're beginning to study the mechanical properties of suspensions like this, in particular the rheology of these. My postdoc, Chasm Edmond, is doing that work. I think we even have all right, so the movie was supposed to be black and white. It's in green and white for some reason. But you can see that these are dynamical structures, and they break and reform when you shear them, and it leads to very interesting flow properties that we're beginning to study in these materials. All right, so that's the work I wanted to tell you about today. These are the people who have done the work. As I said, Stefano Sicana was a big part of this. He's the one who made the Pac-Man particles. He's now in the faculty of the chemistry department at NYU. Gira Yi also, he was one who came up with the idea for the lenses. Chasm Edmond made them. Yufeng Wang, well, Vinnie Manaharn was the one who made the patchy particles. Yufeng Wang and Yu Wang figured out how to put the DNA on them and how to make these colloidal molecules. This is their thesis advisor, Marcus Veck, in the chemistry department. Paul Chaikin and I came up with the idea of Pac-Man and have been working together on that. And the Army and the NSF has supported this work. So if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try and answer your questions.
Some time. So from a self-replicating pattern, there's a competition between lock and key interaction and some kind of DNA specificity. Is that correct?
No. So I don't know how to see if I can go fast enough back through this. All right, so here's the thing. The particle, the DNA here, actually we want to get rid of the DNA. The only reason we want to get rid of the DNA is so there's not DNA involved, some other chemistry. It's purely an aesthetic thing. But that said, DNA is easy to work with and we know how to do it. But it's only used as glue in these experiments, glue that we can turn on and off with temperature. So we have the DNA only on the convex part of these particles. We have a way of doing that. There's no DNA inside here. And we use the depletion interaction to form the copies. These spheres go into these holes by the depletion interaction. These Pac-Man particles go onto the spheres by the depletion interaction. So there's no DNA interaction involved at all here. Once they're together like this, there will be DNA binding between these, all right? That's fine. The main thing, though, is that what that does is it brings the centimate molecules are attached to the DNA strands, and it brings them into very close proximity, that is, on an angstrom scale, so that when you shine the light on them, they will bind irreversibly. So the DNA is used to temporarily hold the particles in place so that we can apply, so that the glue is where it's supposed to be when we shine the light on it. All right, so that's the only role the DNA plays here.
So I guess my follow-up question is it energetically favorable or unfavorable to have mismatches along the sequence?
Mismatches, all right, so the thing, maybe I didn't even say, the DNA interactions between here, notice that red binds to yellow, yellow binds to yellow. The type of DNA the DNA strands we've put on that link together are what we call palindromes. That is, A binds to A because this one has the reverse pattern of this one. I lost track of your question.
You're trying to get defects in the sequence.
All right, so if you get defects, the way you get defects is by, suppose for some reason a big particle got stuck here, all right, and another one came down and got on there, so all of a sudden now you have a big one where you were supposed to have a small one.
But it would still link together.
And the others would be okay, but now you have a new pattern, and presumably next time around it's going to get amplified like the previous one. All right, so there's, or perhaps you start out with a sequence like this one that's 6 long, and by some accident there's another one hanging off here when you turn on the light, and now you have one that's 7 long, or maybe you get fragments. I mean, there's all sorts of ways that this can go wrong. It's sort of like DNA replication, except not nearly as good. There should be a lot, I would expect there to be a lot more mistakes. We'll see.
You teased this at the beginning about the prospect for getting a photonic
Is
there one of the problems that's going to be, it's not even going to be enough to get a nice tetrahedral network, it's got to be a pretty perfect tetrahedral number?
All right, so that's an interesting question. I can't say that phrase without thinking of my colleague, Shura Grossberg. He has a translation of speakers saying that's an interesting question. The translation is, oh, that's a question I've thought about and have a good answer to. But it is sort of an interesting question. All right, so the question is, how perfect does it have to be? There aren't real good calculations on this, but my guess is it doesn't have to be very good at all. I think that the main thing is the tetrahedral coordination, and not even so much the tetrahedral coordination as there not being a lot of contacts. That is, when you have an FCC, as I said before, you have 12 contacts between particles. And I think it has to do with how the electric field distributes itself in a network like this. And there's lots of indications from various calculations that only having a few contacts tends to lead to having band gaps in the structure. So there's also some other things that you know from electronic materials. For example, amorphous silicon still has a band gap. And the analogy is apt here. And so I think it's actually highly likely that if you make an amorphous structure that has tetrahedral coordination, that it will still have a band gap, particularly because the band gap that's calculated for the perfect crystal is so wide. It's a very wide band gap, so it would take quite a bit of disorder to destroy it. So on sure, you'll have states in the gap. You'll have localized states in the gap around the defects, for sure. So the analogies with semiconductors are very much the same because it's just the physics of waves. You have a different dispersion relation is all than you have with electrons. But I do think that the amorphous structure, this is an important question for another reason too, which is a sort of a nastier question you could ask, which is, are these things really going to form diamond crystals? And there's problems with that. In carbon, or in silicon, or other diamond formers, you have quantum mechanics working for you, and that quantum mechanics with the electron binding, basically, when you have a carbon here and you have a carbon here binding through this sp3 orbital, it actually forces the carbon into one of three orientations. It can only have three orientations. That means that those other three bonds point out in a specific set of directions. And so when the other carbons come down to attach, they'll attach along those particular directions, and that supports a diamond lattice. Those are the correct directions. The problem with the colloids is they're degenerate that way. That is, when a colloid attaches along a space like this, it doesn't have just three orientations it can go into. It can go any way it wants. There's no quantum mechanics to force it essentially into three different orientations. And so what that does is that makes it much less likely to form a diamond lattice. So that's one reason why I care about the amorphous structure, because I think it's likely that that's what will form first. Now, there are simulations that suggest that if you use some kind of template, we're building surface templates that have patterned onto it the 111 plane of a diamond crystal, that if you grow it up that way, that you improve your chances for growing a good diamond crystal. But it's by no means a slam dunk. It's something that we need to work on.
Matt, have you thought or played with the idea of reticulum cells? Because the shapes would provide those indentations on opposite faces relative.
Sure. We haven't tried it. I don't know quite why. They may be a little bit on the large side, but in principle, it seems to me you ought to be able to get something like that to work. That is, if you get a sphere that's matched to the size of the red blood cell. I don't know what it's good for. You know, maybe you have somebody you don't like too much that you'd like to.
Or
the shape is different, yeah. Yeah, that's interesting. The question is, what would serve as the depletant? Maybe there's natural things in the blood, maybe the proteins, maybe loose proteins in the blood, or my guess is you might have to increase the concentration in order to get it to happen. Could be.
Jim, you got a question? Just following, you said this thing about maybe they're too large. And I came in late, all right? So did you talk about the size range over which these phenomena occur? You chose a micron, it's very obvious.
Well, so When you're dealing with, all right, so one thing I said at the beginning is that colloids, the sort of size ranges from a few nanometers to a few microns. Basically, you want Brownian motion to be active, all right? And once Brownian motion shuts down, which it does once you get up to, it depends, 10, 20 microns, it depends on what your purposes are, then a lot of these mechanisms don't work so well anymore. So that's a concern. It's just that Brownian motion be active, so that you have sort of an equilibrium thermostated system that obeys statistical mechanics.
And then the lower bound?
The lower bound is sort of arbitrary. The lower bound, in fact, you can view a lot of molecular interactions in as much as they depend on the shape of the atoms and molecules as essentially being the analog of the depletion interaction. It's actually sort of an interesting history, because when the depletion interaction came out back, you know, when people noticed it in the late 80s, early 90s, there ensued a brief period of argumentation between the colloid scientists and liquid state theory people. Eventually everybody made their peace and decided that they were talking about the same thing. You essentially have the analog of this in molecules solution that come together. Sometimes they actually help determine whether two molecules are soluble in each other. So that in some sense there is no lower length scale. The trouble is when you get down to atomic and molecular length scales, is there are a lot of other forces involved, stronger van der Waals forces, stronger electronic forces. While these forces still play a role, it's perhaps not quite as dominant as they are on the larger length scales.
There's one last question from Kenny.
I have two questions.
Sneaky.
On this slide you have here, so am I right that those are complementary strands that you've actually made there? They're not identical, but there's a left-handed and a right-handed version of that.
I don't think so.
Fold it over. Well.
Right, because once you make it like this, you pull it off and you go like this. They're the same thing.
Okay. Well, then the second question is can you get secondary structure?
So we have a whole bunch of ideas for making all sorts of different structures. And in fact, my another person who works on problems like this, Steve Granick, who's at the University of Illinois. He makes patchy particles, but they're sort of a simpler variety. They're sort of either one patch or two patches. He and a few other people have shown with these kinds of particles, if the patches are the right size, you can actually make, I forget what it's called, but essentially they're sort of twisting tetrahedral structures. So you take one tetrahedron and then you pack another pair on and you get this sort of twisting structure that goes like that. So that's a very simple one that emerges quite naturally from these kinds of things. I showed you when you make the patch size bigger, you can have two particles attaching to one patch. So you can play games like that. So my feeling is that if we can gain really good control over this, there ought to be a lot of different structures we can make. I should also pause to say, I was going to include another slide before I ended, but I got a Skype call from a colleague in distress and ended up on the phone. There's a lot of challenges that remain. the way the DNA is attached with the streptavidin biotin link is not a good way to attach the DNA. It's not robust, not for what colloid scientists, the way we abuse colloids. And we find that after about 4 or 5 days, the proteins denature and they no longer work. So we have developed new ways of attaching DNA to the particles, and those are just being perfected now. Another one is on micron-sized particles. When they come together, they tend to come together and stick, and they don't roll around. This is bad if you want to have a structure anneal and find its lowest free energy. All right. Now, there's an article coming out in Nature in a week or two by Vinny Manoharan, my old student, where he's come up with one way of addressing this problem. It's a nice way of addressing it. But the truth is, we don't quite understand why these particles come together and don't roll around. And as evidence of this, one of my students just came to me on Friday and showed me with this new way of attaching DNA to the particles, they come together and all of a sudden these particles roll around. And it doesn't seem like they should. All right. So there are lots of things we don't understand about this system. I mean, we're just sort of, this is all very new. There's lots of problems. And I sort of felt like at the end I was leaving you with a misleading idea that we have everything under control. Far from it. All right. There's lots of work to do here. But I do think we are building up a set of tools that over the next decade or so ought to allow us to make some fairly sophisticated structures on the colloidal size scale. But it'll be work.
So please join me in thanking our speaker.